Okay, so
Today we will just have an introduction to computer systems. It will include some components of the computer, how they are connected, and what logic behind the connection, why they are connected like that, and some history of computer. Okay, all these things will help you to understand different terminology and concept we'll use to explain many topics in our current course. So first thing is that when we go for purchase a computer, what are the features does we look for? You will find that most of the time when you purchase a system, almost every all of us sometimes in our life purchase a desktop or laptop. So what are the features we initially consider? Will find that people are saying that I need this much amount of RAM. Some people will find they are more concerned about CPU. Some of your friends will find they are more concerned about hard disks. No, I need 1 terabyte of memory or more than that. Or some of the students or some of your friends will find they don't like SSD. They will say, no, my laptop should have SSD so that my laptop will run faster. Okay, so why do we think about all these features? And many other features also, some of we consider, some of we don't ignore them. Like if we say, think about a graphics card. You will find that not all the people are concerned about whether there is a good graphics card in the laptop or computer or not. But if that person is interested in playing game, you will find that he is searching for a good graphics card, right? So in the same way, you will find that many people are not concerned about the sound card. But if you find that somebody likes music or he's a singer, or he like to play some instruments, musical instruments. So then you will find they are searching for some good sound card. So, thing is that if you understand all these basics of computer, then you will be able to choose the correct device for you. And definitely you can help others, your organization, to choose the correct device. And next step is, if you know what is the configuration of your device, what is what, then when it will come to security, you will be able to take correct decision at correct time. Say, you got some virus infection on your laptop, and you're taking some help from some security expert online. And he asks you that, okay, you connect something on the HDMI port and say open your laptop and remove the RAM for the time being. Immediately you do it, or if say you are using a desktop, if somebody online is instructing you that okay, you have a real security issue, but you should shut down your computer and remove the hard disks for the time being and until the issues are going to be solved. So all these things, many security issues are also needed to know the knowledge of basic of computer. Okay, so here if you see the different parts of computer, one laptop is disassembled, different parts are shown here. If you see, this is the display screen, then keyword, sorry, then keyboard, central control converter, top cover of the laptop, then CD drive, motherboard, bottom case, fan, hard disk drive, battery, AC adapter, HD RAM module. So you can see if you open a laptop, these are the basic components you will find in a laptop. Okay. So the question is that how those things are going to be connected and how they are helps each other or communicates each other. Okay, so thing is that how does the assemble together in this box, right? So before we go for all these things, we need to know what is computer and what are the basic function of computer, what do we understand, and then automatically we will be able to imagine that what should be the sequence of connecting all these devices. So before that, you need to know what is definition of a computer. So there is many definitions of computer available. First one, this definition is taken from Oxford Dictionary. It is saying that an electronic device for storing and processing data, typically in binary form, according to instruction given to it in a variable program, is computer. But you will find there is other definition, like from dictionary.com, a programmable electronic device designed to accept data, perform prescribed mathematical and logical operation, and at high speed. Definitely we need a high speed, otherwise why should we use computer, right? So at high speed, and display the result of these operations. Another definition is available here from google.com, that is an electronic device which is capable of receiving information or data in a particular form and performing a sequence of operations in accordance with a predetermined but variable set of procedural instruction. So from here to here, just a minute. Okay, just a minute. So from this, if you see this predetermined but variable set of procedural instruction, basically this is definition of a program, okay, instruction to produce a result in the form of information or signal. So this definition is more elaborated and in more expanded definition, you can say. Next, if you see, there are typically all these three definitions, what are they saying? They're saying that the computer it is an electronic device. Yes, sometimes it is an electronic device, it is programmable device, right, which can receive information or data. That that means that it is saying that it is a electronic device. According to first definition, typically in electronic device for storing and processing data, typically in binary form, according to instruction in the in a variable program. Okay, so this device is capable to have some set of instructions. Okay, so some set of, and everywhere you will see this instruction is common. Basically, a set of instruction together forms a program, right? Okay, so set of instruction will be there, and it can accept data. Like here, you can see it can receive information. So basically, it can accept, receive, storing, whatever, for everything it need to take the input, which is some data. And this device, everywhere if you see, you will see that processing data, it is mathematical, perform prescribed mathematical and logical operations. So this is again some kind of process, right? Here in the last one also, you will see that performing a sequence of operation. Okay, that is another, nothing but a process. So it processes. And it gives some output in different definition, it is saying in different way. Right, in the last definition, if you see, in form of information or signals, this output can be some kind of info, it can be signal, right? If it is say music, the outcome is music or some video, basically they are signals, right? So like that. So you have a computer which takes input, it processes and generates output. So this is the simple outcome or bottom line of all this definition we have seen in previous slide. Next, so we have spoken about a computer needs to have some input and output. So we all know that there is input devices, there is output devices. So yeah, I don't need to explain them, right? Keyboard and mouse, mic, all these things are input devices. Then your monitor, your sound system, printer, all these are your output devices. And there are some devices which can used as input and output devices in both ways. Now come to the history of computer. So definitely we start from India, right? Around 800 AD, zero was invented in India. And definitely, zero is having huge contribution in computer science, because we understand computer understand on off, zero and one, right? So you can understand. Then 1642, Pascal adding machine. So this is adding machine. This is a automation of addition. So there was no electronic. Okay, only it is a mechanical thing. Okay, it was a mechanical way of doing addition. Then 1679, binary number system was invented by Gottfried Leibniz in Germany. Okay, so you can understand the whole computer science, everything we explain in binary term, which is came just only in 1679. This binary number system, that means there can be a number system using two bits, 0 and 1. And how one decimal one will be presented, decimal two. Arithmetic rules came far later. Okay, so it should not be here. Okay, it came far later. Then 1751, electricity came. Again, you can understand electricity was another important thing to evaluate computer systems. Benjamin Franklin, I think all of you knows his name. And the story how he had failed the electricity and invented it. Then in 1801, just before I think 220 years, textile loom came. So textile loom is a Joseph Jacob, invented by Joseph Jacquard in France. So what is this, what was there in this machine? There was punch card. So this punch card was used to stitch different design on cloths. Okay, according to punch card, the design was used to be printed. Okay, so that was the concept later adopted from here to develop a computer. Okay, so that is the reason how textile loom, helps in the evolution of computer. So I do know who is this person. So he is the father of computer, Charles Babbage. You can see 1833 in UK, Charles Babbage proposed the first computer. It was called as analytical engine. Okay, proposed using the punch card like Jacquard's loom to make it programmable. Okay, Siddha Gautam, he had used that concept of Panchkarma and tried to, you know, make it programmable. Even this was not, you know, proper, you know, it was not support the proper definition of computer, and it was not a electronic device in that sense. Okay, but it was automation, and we still give the credit of an invention of computer to Charles Babbage. Now next, you can see after that, 1854, Boolean algebra came. George Boole in the UK invented the Boolean algebra. That means the addition of binary number and other arithmetic operations. Okay. Then, 1936, the arithmetic programming, the automatic programming was invented by and proposed by Alan Turing. So many of you have heard about the name of Alan Turing, right? So he is quite a famous man, and he's also credited as father of theoretical computation. Okay, so still you can understand he had proposed definitely different models of computing, and there was basically theory. Okay, because still that time, electronic, what we understand today by electronics, that was not developed up to that mark. But in 1948, transistor was invented by John Bardeen in USA. So I think most of you know and have seen these devices in your labs or in different devices in your home, right? So that was a huge, you can say move forward towards development of electronic computers. Okay, it will change the way the computer development was going on before 1948. Okay, then in 1949, magnetic core memory was invented by Ann Wang in USA. So it is a kind of magnet maze, and they was able to capture information into magnetic maze. Okay, so that was called magnetic core memory. Then 1952, the first programming language came, which is called COBOL in USA. Okay, so you can understand this was the the transforming time. The first programming language came. Even at that time, good operating system was available. Okay, then 1958, integrated circuit was developed by Jack Gilvey and Robert Nursey. Okay, so this is I think all of you know that, right? This integrated circuit, it was first came into 1958, and definitely you can understand that this integrated circuit are going to play a huge role to develop small computers, right? You see, 1964, IBM System 360, and developed by IBM in USA. This is a computer. You will not understand whether this operator is sitting inside the computer or in front of computer. He's sitting inside the computer, right? So that is the size in 1964, just before around 60 years, right? Then 1969, Unix was developed by Bell Labs. Unix is the first operating system was developed, and it was developed for some device developed by the Bell Lab. Okay, and later it was developed as a general operating system, and still now we use Unix-based operating system, right? Many operating systems are there. Even your Android on your phone is based on Unix. Okay, then 1972, first 8-bit microprocessor was developed by Intel. So you can understand the first 8-bit microprocessor came in 1972, and you can understand that the size of computer is going to be smaller and smaller from this time. Okay, 1989 to 1993, the worldwide way the concept came in term of for family. Before that, the networks was there, but it was not being called as internet or www because it was not available for the public. It was available for research purpose, for military purpose, and for the national goods or communication, government communications. They was using it, but first time around 1993, it started becoming popular among general public. Okay, then you can see the first generation computer. This during this time, the computers used 1940 to 1956 was called as the first generation computer. You will find very basic electronic element into it. Okay, even I doubt whether there. I think yes, some electronic equipment was there, like vacuum tube for circuitry and magnetic drums for memory was used in that time. Then what was the problem is space. Huge space was required due to as it was designed based on vacuum tubes and magnetic drums, there was not a small devices, right? Then electricity consumption, heat generation, malfunction and breakdowns was issue for this computer. So only machine level language was available for that time, and one program at a time. There was no multitasking. Okay, so input method was punch card or paper tape, and output was only printout. Okay. Then the second generation came, 1956 to 1963. These computers was using semiconductors, making computers smaller, faster, cheaper, and less heavy on electricity use. And language evolved from cryptic binary language to symbolic assembly language, and early versions of COBOL and Fortran came during this time, right? So first computer to store instruction into their memories are the second generation computers. Then third generation computers, during 1964 to 1971, transistors were now being miniatured and put on the silicon chips, and massive increase in speed and efficiency. Fast computers of using keyboard and monitors with interface with an operating system, run several applications at once and using central program, and it became cheaper and smaller. Okay. Then fourth generation computer came. Intel was the big player in fourth generation computer. Then fourth generation time, you can see 1972 to 2010. So microprocessor with CPU memory, input output controls was started used, and Intel chip housed thousands of integrated circuit inside it. And 1981 shows the first ever computer by IBM, and 1984 shows the Macintosh introduced by Apple. Next comes the fifth generation, what we are using right now in 2010 onwards. Artificial intelligence is the big thing right now, and parallel processing and semiconductors became the backbone of the design and development of these kind of computers. So here is the summarization of all these five generations. Next, there is supercomputer. Supercomputers are used for parallel processing, or they are suitable for doing parallel processing. And then mainframe computers, they multi-user time sharing, and they work in term of MIPS. So what is MIPS? What is petaflops? We will discuss later. Okay. Then mini computers, multi-user time-sharing computers is smaller than the mainframe. Microcomputers are the PCs and workstations, first by Apple, later IBM introduced it. and embedded computers like microcontroller. It is used in car, MP3 players, washing machine in your home, and etc. Okay, and then comes there is two component, the two main components of computer. One is called hardware, another is software. You all know, right? Hardware are those physical element of computer, and software is commonly known as programs or apps, consist of all the instruction that tells the hardware how to perform a task. Okay, and what is the relation between hardware, software, and all? Is that hardware is only the physical element. They don't, they can't be controlled themselves, and they can't do anything without you give some instruction. Okay, so they don't have any brain. So there is system software which understand the hardware, which can speak with hardware. Okay, you do this, you do that, you printer, you print something, or display, you need to display this video. All this instruction can be given by system software, but the system softwares are so complex and so generic, they are not going to be interact with the user directly. For user, it will be again a harder task to interact with the system softwares all the time. So what happens, we have application softwares so that we can get application specific software or our work specific software. Like I want to type something, so I want a text editor. Why do I bother about other applications, right? If I want to just play a video, I want to play video player. I don't want to be bothered about other functionalities possible on the computer. Okay, so we need individual applications for our individual purposes, so that we install, and those application softwares interacts with us, that means with the user. Okay, and user gives instruction to the application software, and application softwares gives instruction to the system software, and system software finally gives instruction to the hardware. So this is the relationship among them. Okay, now how come does the computer work? The concept can be clear by this example. Say we want to execute or we want to calculate x cube by computer. Okay, that means what? We have a computer which should have some application program, right, which will calculate the x^q problem. So in general, when we're not writing the code, the steps to be taken to calculate this, we write it by pseudocode. So for doing this pseudocode, pseudocode for fx equal to x^3 can be, first you compute x into x, that means x square. Okay, then you compute x square into x, which will give you x cube. Then you can display or whatever. Okay, so when you will have these two instruction, first instruction will be, we'll go to CPU, and CPU will try to execute it. While it try to execute, it will find that, okay, x is a variable and that value is not given. So what it will do? It will search the value in the temporary memory. What is x? Okay. So if it does not get the value of x there, it will ask you for the input. Okay, so it will ask you for input. So input x equal to 2 is given. Okay, then what will happen? Then the CPU will calculate x square, that is 2 into 2 equal to 4, and it will store in the temporary memory again. Now what will happen? That means what? Z is nothing but x square, right? Now what will happen? The next instruction will be calculated. The x square, this value will be searched by the CPU, and it will find this value in the temporary memory, and then it will easily can calculate x square into x, and which will be x cube equal to, say, 4 is x square into 2 equal to 8, right? So in this way it will calculate and it will store that result for the time being in the temporary memory, okay? Then it will display the result on the screen. So this is how the whole thing is going to be over. The computer is going to be over. Okay. Give me 1 minute, please. Hello. Okay. Thank you. Hello. Oh, sorry. Hello.
Yes, sir.
989523. 23. Okay. Sorry for the disturbance. So this is how the calculation will be done. Now, how these things, this diagram, what we have seeing on the screen, is relates to our real physical computer, correct? So look at this. Your program memory, where this instruction or program was stored, is nothing but your hard disk, HDD. Some people are having SSD, solid state device, right? Then CPU is nothing but this kind of chip. I think many of you are familiar, with Core i7 chip. This kind of sticker you will find on your devices and all, right? The temporary memory is nothing but the RAM. This is an image of RAM, okay? Then output, you all again understand, output is displayed on the monitor and input is by the keyboard. So the concept is clear, I think, to you, that how a computer system actually work and how these different devices are logically and physically, helping to and coordinating with each other to do a operation, correct? So how they are connected? They are connected like this. So this is nothing but a motherboard, okay? You can see these are hard disks. So this is a hard disks, this is a CD player, a CD ROM or drive, whatever. Then say this is a SSD. All of them you can see are connected with these two motherboard. Okay. Then if you see, there is a power button which is just connected with this SMPS, which is the power source of your computer, right? And you can see here the RAMs are inserted on the motherboard itself, and these are basically the fans, which will be put on the processor, because your processor is going to produce heat when it is going to work. Okay, so this is the concept of computer, how they are work. Okay. So after this, do you have any doubt or any question?